This was the kind of tale they told, and as always, with a certain amount of exasperation, because while all of them knew that in the bush of Africa are waiting valuable drugs locked in bark, in simple-looking leaves, in roots, it was impossible to ever get the truth about them from the natives themselves. The story eventually reached town, and perhaps it was at a sundowner party or some such function that a doctor who happened to be there challenged it. "Nonsense," he said. "These things get exaggerated in the telling. We are always checking up on this kind of story, and we draw a blank every time." Anyway, one morning there arrived a strange car at the homestead, and out stepped one of the workers from the laboratory in town, with cases full of test tubes and chemicals. Mr. and Mrs. Farquhar were flustered and pleased and flattered. They asked the scientist to lunch, and they told the story all over again for the 100th time. Little Teddy was there too, his blue eyes sparkling with health, to prove the truth of it. The scientist explained how humanity might benefit if this new drug could be offered for sale, and the Farquhars were even more pleased. They were kind, simple people who liked to think of something good coming about because of them. But when the scientist began talking of the money that might result, their manner showed discomfort. Their feelings over the miracle, that was how they thought of it, were so strong and deep and religious that it was distasteful to them to think of money. The scientist, seeing their faces, went back to his first point, which was the advancement of humanity. He was perhaps a trifle perfunctory. It was not the first time he had come salting the tale of a fabulous bush secret. Eventually, when the meal was over, the Farquhars called Gideon into their living room and explained to him that this boss here was a big doctor from the big city, and he had come all the way to see Gideon. At this, Gideon seemed afraid. He did not understand, and Mrs. Farquhar explained quickly that it was because of the wonderful thing he had done with Teddy's eyes that the big boss had come. Gideon looked from Mrs. Farquhar to Mr. Farquhar, and then at the little boy, who was showing great importance because of the occasion. At last he said grudgingly, "The big boss wants to know what medicine I used?" He spoke incredulously, as if he could not believe his old friends could so betray him. Mr. Farquhar began explaining how a useful medicine could be made out of the root, and how it could be put on sale, and how thousands of people, black and white, up and down the continent of Africa, could be saved by the medicine when that spitting snake filled their eyes with poison. Gideon listened, his eyes bent on the ground, the skin of his forehead puckering in discomfort. When Mr. Farquhar had finished, he did not reply. The scientist, who all this time had been leaning back in a big chair, sipping his coffee and smiling with skeptical good humor, chipped in and explained all over again in different words about the making of drugs and the progress of science. Also, he offered Gideon a present. There was silence after this further explanation, and then Gideon remarked indifferently that he could not remember the root. His face was sullen and hostile. Even when he looked at the Farquhars, whom he usually treated like old friends, they were beginning to feel annoyed, and this feeling annulled the guilt that had been sprung into life by Gideon's accusing manner. They were beginning to feel that he was unreasonable. But it was at that moment that they all realized he would never give in. The magical drug would remain where it was, unknown and useless except for the tiny scattering of Africans who had the knowledge, natives who might be digging a ditch for the municipality in a ragged shirt and a pair of patched shorts, but who were still born to healing, hereditary healers, being the nephews or sons of the old witch doctors, whose ugly masks and bits of bone and all the uncouth properties of magic were the outward signs of real power and wisdom. The Farquhars might tread on that plant 50 times a day as they passed from house to garden, from cow crawl to mealy field, but they would never know it. But they went on persuading and arguing with all the force of their exasperation, and Gideon continued to say that he could not remember, or that there was no such root, or that it was the wrong season of the year, or that it wasn't the root itself, but the spit from his mouth that had cured Teddy's eyes. He said all these things one after another, and seemed not to care that they were contradictory. He was rude and stubborn. The Farquhars could hardly recognize their gentle, lovable old servant in this ignorant, perversely obstinate African, standing there in front of them with lowered eyes, his hands twitching his cook's apron, repeating over and over whichever one of the stupid refusals that first entered his head. And suddenly he appeared to give in. He lifted his head, gave a long, blank, angry look at the circle of whites, who seemed to him like a circle of yelping dogs pressing around him, and said, "I will show you the route." They walked single file away from the house homestead down a Kaffir path. It was a blazing December afternoon, with the sky full of hot rain clouds. Everything was hot. The sun was like a bronze tray whirling overhead. There was a heat shimmer over the fields. The soil was scorching underfoot. The dusty wind blew gritty and thick and warm in their faces. It was a terrible day, fit only for reclining on a veranda with iced drinks, which is where they would normally have been at that hour. From time to time, remembering that on the day of the snake it had taken 10 minutes to find the route, someone asked, "Is it much further, Gideon?" And Gideon would answer over his shoulder with angry politeness, "I'm looking for the route, boss." And indeed, he would frequently bend sideways and trail his hand among the grasses with a gesture that was insulting in its own perfunctoriness. He walked them through the bush along unknown paths for 2 hours in that melting, destroying heat, so that the sweat trickled coldly down them and their heads ached. They were all quite silent. The Farquhars became, because they were angry. The scientist, because he was being proved right again. There was no such plant. His was a tactful silence. At last, 6 miles from the house, Gideon suddenly decided they had had enough, or perhaps his anger evaporated at that moment. He picked up, without an attempt at looking anything but casual, a handful of blue flowers from the grass, flowers that had been growing plentifully all down the paths they had come. He handed them to the scientist without looking at him, and marched off by himself on the way home, leaving them to follow him if they chose. When they got back to the house, the scientist went to the kitchen to thank Gideon. He was being very polite, even though there was an amused look in his eyes. Gideon was not there. Throwing the flowers casually into the back of his car, the eminent visitor departed on his way back to his laboratory. Gideon was back in his kitchen in time to prepare dinner, but he was sulking. He spoke to Mr. Farquhar like an unwilling servant. It was days before they liked each other again. The Farquhars made inquiries about the route from their laborers. Sometimes they were answered with distrustful stares. Sometimes the natives said, "We do not know. We have never heard of the route." One, the cattle boy, who had been with them a long time and had grown to trust them a little, said, "Ask your boy in the kitchen. Now there's a doctor for you. He's the son of a famous medicine man who used to be in these parts, and there's nothing he cannot cure." Then he added politely, "Of course, he's not as good as the white man's doctor. We know that. But he's good for us." After some time, when the soreness had gone from between the Farquhars and Gideon, they began to joke. "When are you going to show us the snake route, Gideon?" And he would laugh and shake his head, saying a little uncomfortably, "But I did show you, missus. Have you forgotten?" Much later, Teddy, as a schoolboy, would come into the kitchen and say, "You old rascal, Gideon, do you remember that time you tricked us all by making us walk miles all over the veld for nothing? It was so far my father had to carry me." And Gideon would double up with polite laughter. After much laughing, he would suddenly straighten himself up, wipe his old eyes, and look sadly at Teddy, who was grinning mischievously at him across the kitchen. "Ah, little yellowhead, how you have grown. Soon you will be grown up with a farm of your own."